This is NDTV. And you're watching Classics.
Hello and welcome to the Unstoppable Indians. Every week we take a journey into the life of an outstanding Indian, a person whose talent, acumen or moral example is transforming India. The best, the finest from every field join me, Manvi Dhillon, on this show to share their life story, their journey to success, some of the knocks along the way, what made them get up and keep going, what makes them an unstoppable Indian. My guest today is quite simply Sourabh Ganguly. I do not need to say any more. Sourabh, thank you so much for making the time. It's an absolute pleasure. You're here back in Delhi. We're here at the Lalit Hotel in Delhi for the Ranji. What's it like to be back on the field?
Oh, it's different. After I finished the test match in Nagpur, I didn't even pick a cricket bat. So I didn't know where my stuff was. So to turn up and play a Ranji Trophy game in a month's time with no training, no practice was different.
Yeah. I want to go back to the very beginning, and you know, a lot of this is ground that's been covered because Sourabh Ganguly is a phenomena, but I'm going to cover that ground regardless. Football was your first love. Have the cricketing years overshadowed the love, original love for football, or do you remember what it felt like to play football and love the game?
Yes, it did. Yes, it did. You know, with the amount of time I've spent playing cricket, it's obviously overshadowed my love for the sport. But you know, being a Calcuttan, and everybody knew how to kick a football. So when I grew up in school, I never played cricket. And we used to participate in school football tournaments. Only when I went out of school, I passed out of class 9. And the opportunity for playing football had decreased in a long way. So then I started picking up a cricket bat. Before that, it was all soccer.
And it was your brother who drew you towards cricket. Were you somewhat reluctant or skeptical?
At that stage, I was so young, I hardly used to worry what I was doing, you know. At 14, 15, you don't think much in life. You know, you just enjoy doing a whole lot of things. My brother used to go to practice at Eden Gardens, which used to be a big cricket ground then. So I used to love going with him and just picking cricket balls. I could never get an opportunity to bat in the nets because I was young and I was not the part of the group which was actually training at Eden Gardens. So I used to go pick cricket balls, and they had a coach named Mr. Parmar. And he supported Bengal cricket for a long, long time. So he just told me one day, you come every day, pick cricket balls. Why don't you just come and have a hit at the end of the practice? So I was elated. I didn't have kit. My brother used to have all the kits. So I took his kit and practiced with him for a few days. And then he said that I should take up cricket.
And that was obviously a turning point. Do you remember your international debut at all?
Oh, yeah.
And do you remember the thoughts and your mind space at that time? Take us through that.
I remember every ball of my first test match at Lord's. You know, it's a memory which will last me till I live probably. And the first ball, how I played, what I did when I got to a 50, what shot I played to get to 100, everything. You know, the thought process I had at that time when I played my first test, and after that I've played 113 test matches, and I've never had that thought process in my life. You know, my mind never thought so simply, in a simpler way as I did in that test match.
And when you look back at, you know, you've said something very interesting there, because obviously the simplicity of your approach to the game would have been lost over time as you play more and more. But the thrill of your performance, have you ever been able to match that feeling of thrill in the later years compared to the thrill you felt in the earlier years?
Oh, yes. Yes, you know.
So you don't become jaded?
No, you don't. Because, you know, it's a thing which you want to do. It's a thing which you love to do the most. So, you know, as time goes on, you go through different challenges. You know, when I got my place in the team in 1996, I tried to establish myself, you know, get runs in the test match and get a regular place in the side. Then a few years down the line, I became captain. Then the successes started coming with Indian cricket, and you know, there were happier times. You know, you felt happy with the successes of the team, with the wins and in the way the team played. And then once I was not captain, and I came back into the team as a player with my performances, every time I performed at the time when the team wanted a big performance from someone, obviously, you know, it changes, but that fun, that challenge never finishes.
Never goes. And I'm going to talk about each of those moments in your life, because there have been so many memorable moments. But tell me, commentators say you're an impulsive cricketer. Is that an extension of who Sourabh Ganguly is in life? Is impulsive, or is
yes,
that...
Yes, my life's pretty simple. You know, I have certain values, which I believe, and I try and keep it simple. Simple things make me happy. and that's the way I lead it. And it's the same on the cricket field. You know, I did whatever I felt was, I thought was right for the Indian team to win, and I could have been wrong. You know, it's a decision which I had to take on the field and in split seconds. It was not something which I would ponder. I didn't have so much time on a cricket field. So it had to be impulsive, and I'm sure that every good captain is impulsive, because you know, you can have a whole lot of meetings, you can take a whole lot of plannings, and when you walk onto the park, it could be something completely different.
Something you hadn't anticipated. Tell
yes.
me, this is an unfair one, but batting versus bowling, how do the two compare in your career, in your life?
I'm basically a batsman.
Yes, but you've had those glorious moments in bowling as well.
Yes, and I've bowled a bit for India whenever the team required, especially in conditions which helped seamers a bit.
Right.
I've enjoyed my bowling because, you know, it's one aspect of the game where I didn't have much pressure.
Right.
It was an addition to my quality as a batsman. So there was less pressure and I enjoyed it.
There are so many commentators who say that Sourav Ganguly is the best captain the Indian cricket team has ever had. And I want to see this through your eyes. What kind of captain were you?
It's very difficult for me to say what kind of captain I was. You know, I had two theories that I wanted India to win. And when I became captain, I had to build a team. There were a lot of young boys who were talented, you know, who needed to be shown the way. And I remember when I first became captain, we just had three seniors in the team. Myself, Sachin, Rahul and Anil. The four of us were seniors and the rest of them were all young guys. So we had to build the team. So.
But you know, it takes guts to also back unproven talent, and you did that.
I had a policy. I felt that, you know, if when you pick someone, you need to show him that you have faith in him, because, you know, once a cricketer gets picked for the country, he has enough pressures. And I realized that once you pick someone, his only pressure should be how to hit the red ball. He should not worry about other things when he walks out to bat. His place in the side, what's going to happen if he fails, what the captain thinks about him, what the selectors think about him. So I had a certain policy in my mind that if I pick someone, I'll give him a fair run for him to be successful. Obviously, you know, you have demands as a captain. You want a match winner. You want somebody to stand up and get test 100, especially when the team requires you to do so. But I always felt that if I wanted the best out of a player, I had to give him an atmosphere where he could play freely.
One of your team members said he would die for a captain like you. And you know, for a leader, that is almost the most rewarding thing to hear. Because that's the kind of sentiment that most leaders in corporations, in cricket teams, in any form, are really looking for, because that's testimony.
That's nice to hear, but obviously it's come out from from the relationship I had with a lot of cricketers. You know, they knew that what I was on my face. It was not something on the face and something behind, and they knew that if they had a tough time, I would be next to them.
And yet you were a tough leader.
I was, because I had to, because we needed results. You know, Indian cricket was going through a phase where a lot of players had left. We had to bring in young players, but at the same time, with this sport in India, you have to give results. So you had to balance both.
And something about the mental makeup of the team seemed to shift under your captaincy. Suddenly it wasn't a soft team anymore. Suddenly had a lot of aggression and a fighting spirit. And was that something you were conscious of as a change that took place? Could you see it?
Yes, it did. But it also had to do a lot with the individual players. You know, I've always believed that a captain is as good as his team. So it was important to have the right bunch of players who had ability and who would perform in all conditions. And I was lucky, you know, I had people like Sachin, Rahul, VVS, Anil, Sehwag, Zaheer, Harbhajan, who were probably playing their best cricket during that period when I was captain.